The first annex includes a roadmap towards the creation of the Bangsamoro region. Members of the Transition Commission have also been named. The commission will draft the Bangsamoro Basic Law. So how does the Sabah conflict affect the peace process? And let's understand the gains being made on the peace process. GPH Peace Panel Chief Professor Miriam Coronel Ferrer joins us today to answer many questions and help us understand the situation. Professor, good morning.
Good
Thank
morning.
You so
Thank
much
you.
For coming over. All right. Let me first start with the Sabah conflict, because many are saying that this actually also happened because the sultanates, at least their group, felt that they were not recognized, they were not part of the peace process. Is this true or not?
Well, you know, everybody's part of the peace process, and the Sulu Sultanate, the descendants have always remained social institutions in their communities, and that is why they have been among the people that we have met with and engaged in consultations. So, and I don't think that they were against the peace agreement. What they are feeling now is that their issue with regards to their proprietary claims to Sabah have not been duly addressed, but
right.
It doesn't run counter to the fact that we have been in negotiations with the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, that we have always been guided by the principles of inclusivity in this whole process, that we have actually put their concerns are reflected in the provisions of the framework agreement, the recognition of customary laws, traditions, traditional leaders who continue to play significant roles in their society. These have all been taken into account. But the matter of the proprietary claims to Sabah, you'd need another negotiating table for that.
In other words, you're saying, Professor, the proprietary claim is definitely not within the bounds or the jurisdiction or the responsibility of the peace process between the government and the MILF.
Yes, we do.
Is that something you could touch on?
Well, touch on in with reference to the other implications in the security front. We know that we cannot help that Sulu and Tawi-Tawi will be are now experiencing some kind of difficulties, tension because of the prolonged standoff that is taking place. So all of this we are assessing and evaluating. But as far as the infrastructure for the negotiations, these are firmly in place.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, so we have the negotiating table, which is the government and the Moro Islamic Liberation Front. And in this case, Malaysia is not a party. Malaysia is the facilitator. The Sabah issue would have to be put on another table where, in fact, Malaysia will be one of the parties and not the facilitator.
In other words, it has to be brought possibly to another court, maybe the international court. Malaysia is not assisting the Philippines. It cannot be assisting the Philippines in this claim because both countries can lay claim.
Well, there are many options that the government can do, and that is, of course, up to the President and Department of Foreign Affairs to define.
Not the government and not this peace process. That's really basically what you're saying, Professor. Right?
Not this table.
Okay. But were they left out? What kind of consultation did you have, at least, or participation did you get from this group?
We met with the three brothers in a hotel in Ortigas, which was the second meeting actually on the on this with them. First with their spokesperson.
Abraham Ijirani? Is this still the spokesperson
yes.
you spoke?
Yes, okay. The first time in 2011, and several months after we met with the three brothers. Sultan Jamalul III himself, brothers Ismail and Agbimuddin, and their wives as well. And we listened carefully to their concerns.
Yeah.
On some items that we felt that we can do something about, we tried to address this.
Like what, Professor?
You know, from the very beginning, the government panel has acknowledged that this part of Mindanao has different narratives, that they do have a special history of their own, and that is why we said that one of the things that we'd like to do is to acknowledge the multiple narratives that exist. And the Sulu Sultanate has a very special role in that society. And to that extent, we identified things that we can do now in terms of restoring some of the recognition and dignity of the Sultanate.
We talk-
We talked about the possibility of constructing a historical marker on the gravesite of the late Sultan Jamalul. All of this, we did try to undertake some of the preliminary steps to be able to address that component, which is very important to, with reference to the acknowledgement the historical role of the Sultanate.
And it was very important for them as well.
It was very important for them. But of course, for them, the core issue has to do with the proprietary
ownership.
And we did pass on the documents that were given to us at the time.
You passed it on to
the Department of Foreign
Affairs. The FAA, okay. What kind of, I mean, just the look back when you had that meeting in a hotel in Ortigas with the three brothers, when you couldn't really tackle or, you could discuss, but you couldn't really decide on or find solutions to the core problem. How did that meeting end? Were they
discussing? It was very cordial. I think we were able to establish some kind of friendly relationship. And, you know, it's not only the government panel that's been meeting with them. The MLF panel have also met with them. The chairman himself, Chairman Mohager Iqbal, as well as other members, like I understand the panel member, Alkam Lian, who, of course, hails from that part, of the island parts of Mindanao.
Let me ask you this, Professor. During the signing in Malacanang, were the kirams there?
Yes, we made sure that they were in the guest list.
Did they make it?
The Sultan Jamalul, I understand, was in attendance. Yes, he was there. Unfortunately, I was not able to move around at that time.
Okay.
But I understand that he did come to the framework agreement. Like I said, they are not against the peace negotiation. They are not against the peace process. But they have issues that they wish to be addressed as well.
Professor, I hope you don't mind. Mm-hmm. We have Jaz Al-Kiram, she's also listening to us and possibly watching us while we're discussing this. All right, Jazel, hi, good morning to you. Jazel, can you hear me? Yes,
hello?
yes, I'm speaking to you. Hi, yeah, this is Pinky.
Yes, I can hear you, but it's not clear.
Oh, it's not clear? We're going to try again, all right? Siguro we're having a little bit of a problem. Am I coming in clearer now? Naririnig mo na ba ako?
No, I can hear you, but I cannot understand. It's not clear.
Okay, we'll get back to you a little later on. We'll try to fix that. We apologize for that. Balikan na lang natin. All right, so they're not against the peace process per se, but I guess the core really is the proprietary claim or ownership, which is, you've made it very clear, Professor.
Yes.
That's over and beyond your scope.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let me just go back to that. So Jamalul Kiram III was actually there during the signing.
I was told that they came over with they can validate that now. But as I said, I think like everyone else, they do want to build peace in Mindanao, especially in on Sulu Islands, the islands there. They are just like everybody else who wants to find an end to the armed conflict so that everybody can live normal lives, but then they do have this issue that we'll have to find settlement soon, and at the end of the day, it will have to be settled through negotiation as
And I guess, Professor, you know, the President has spoken. He's already asked the DFA and the DOJ to look into this, and I think the Secretary Laila De Lima will give the President some sort of conclusion or recommendation on this. But let's go back, because the peace process has somehow not been talked about and since the signing, that historic signing in Malacanang. You know, we were talking about, you know, as far back as I can remember, Professor, we were all wondering who's going to be part of this transition council, who are going to be members of that, because that would be important, because sila yung, they will the one that will be creating the laws for this peace agreement. Let's start with this. There are supposed to be four annexes to the framework.
Right.
So four parts of the framework.
Four documents that will be attached as part of the comprehensive agreement that will include the framework agreement plus the annexes.
It's like these are the specifics. These are the terms of reference. Okay. You recently, about a week ago, signed the first annex, which is the Transitional Arrangements and Modalities, or TAM. What is that?
It's the annex that details the process or the roadmap that will be undertaken. And actually, we do have a very unique design in this negotiation process that even as we are still completing all the documents, we are beginning to implement. So the roadmap does talk about the creation of the Transition Commission, which has already been done. Executive Order 120, issued by the President in December, already put it into effect. And last week, the members of the Transition Commission have all been appointed. So we expect that the Transition Commission will be convening very soon to start their work of drafting a draft Bangsamoro basic law.
Professor, just so we understand it better, the Transition Commission is almost like the CONCON, right? The Constitutional Commission, something like that. They're the ones.
It's a body that will draft an organic law. Of course, in the course of their discussions, they might feel that some items would need some changes in the Constitution, but that is up to them. But the primary function, the number one function of the body, is to produce a draft document that will be submitted to Congress. And Congress, of course, will be the one to legislate on this, on the final law that will serve as the legal framework of the Bangsamoro political entity.
How much time are they being given, the Transitional Council or Commission?
I think as soon as they, the idea here is that they finish coming up with a draft as soon as possible, so that this can be submitted to the next Congress. And as in any organic act, it will have to go through the plebiscite that that will be defined as guided by the framework agreement, the core territory that has been defined in the framework agreement. And so the whole idea is to go through the plebiscite, institute.
That's right.
A transition authority between the abolition of the arm and the regular elections for the Bangsamoro government in 2016.
All right, so by that time, there will be no more arm by 2016. That was what the president was saying.
The new law.
Actually, by 2015, right?
As soon as the new law takes effect, which is after the plebiscite, because the plebiscite will determine the acceptance of the people.
Absolutely, yeah.
And the territorial coverage of the Bangsamoro entity.
And the plebiscite will only be for the areas covered.
For the areas covered.
Yeah,
it's not
going
like,
to be
actually, it's not a constitutional amendment which will require ratification by everybody.
So there is a time frame for this. I understand, of course, when the president was talking about this, and Associate Justice Marvick Leonin, when he was talking, he was talking about this. They wanted this over and done with, at least on the transition before the president's term ends.
Yes, because the whole idea is to put something permanent.
Yeah.
So that it can continue on to the next administration. And the permanent institution that we are building is this Bangsamoro new political entity.
Yeah. You were quoted as saying that you're very happy with that round of talks. It was a very fruitful talk you had. So most important here, Professor, so we understand it better, is the formation of that, you call it a TransCom?
The TransCom, because on the first day of talks, the members have been appointed, which means that they should
be
continuing.
How many are they?
There are 15 of them.
Okay.
It's quite a good mix, I would say. There are there are four women, and we're very happy about that. They come from different geographic areas, ethnicities or tribes, as we might say. They have a good kind of background, and I think all the goodwill that will be necessary to be able to work together.
So there are four women. Who else?
Let me see. There are four lawyers out of 15, two men, two women, including among them are, former ambassador to Iraq, Bahrain, and Oman, actually for a long time, an ambassador, Honorable Ahmad Sakam. Also a former congressman, three-termer congressman from the 2nd District of Sulu, that's Honorable Asani S. Tamang. The two lawyers, the two women lawyers, are no other than the head of our legal panel, a graduate of the UP College of Law and a top-notcher in the Foreign Service Officers exam last year, Johaira Wahab, plus Raisa Jajuri, who a human rights lawyer who has been working for a long time in Mindanao, Atausug as well, and founder of Nisa Ulhaq Bangsa Moro, which is a women in the justice organization for women in the Bangsa Moro. So I think we do have a very good set of people there.
Yeah. Yes. Any members from, what about members from the MILF?
Mm-hmm.
How many from government, the MILF, MNLF?
Yes. But you know, eventually that distinction should be erased because it will have to be a
They're
collective
supposed to be
body.
Working together, yes, as a team.
Right, well, from the MNLF, no less than the chair of their negotiating panel, Mohager Iqbal, who has a master's in political science from Manila and has written several books, of course, on the peace negotiations.
Okay.
There's also the vice deputy chief of the Bangsa Moro Islamic Armed Forces, Sage Sani, let me see, and Hussein Munoz,
okay.
The head of their ceasefire committee, which is Said Sheikh, all of whom have very good familiarity with what have been discussed in the negotions. Amaranao, also a graduate of political science, Bobby Alonto, Sharia law expert, Sharia judge, Sharia law expert from their end, Ibrahim Ali, and actually also we do have also a professor of Sharia law at the University, Mindanao State University, the former dean of the King Faisal University, Professor Benito, Talib A. Benito.
Wow, okay. Mm. All right. Where are they supposed to meet? Where are they supposed to be drafting
well,
the law?
Well, these are what they're working on now. Office, staffing, committees that they will be
put Professor
up.
But Professor Banyan, kanya-kanya, and then eventually they'll come together. Or are they going to be housed in one office talking about this, like, you know, senators maybe?
They will have an office. They will have to do consultations.
Okay.
They'll probably break up into committees dividing the different topics
right.
and so that they can work
all
right. at the same time.
But you know, I'm wondering, that this was a historic day for Malacanang, and not just Malacanang, obviously the MILF too. This happened in October, November, December, February. You signed this sometime end of February. Why did it take 4 months? Or is that slow? Or are you actually within the timetable, if there is a timetable? There is somehow
yes,
a timetable, but 4 months before the Transcom?
Well, we have mutually adjusted our schedules. That's in keeping, I think, with the collegiality that have defined the process. The important thing here is that what we come up with is something that we can both defend publicly and we can both implement as well.
Okay.
So if it's taking a long time, it's because we're really sorting out the difficulties in the issues. Yeah.
All right. Let's go back to the what was written in the prompter a little while ago, that when I was asking the professor if the Sultanate of Sulu was actually present during the signing of that peace accord between the MILF and the government. I understand that Secretary Edwin Lacerda did confirm or is confirming that Jamalul Kiram was actually present during the signing of that peace deal. He was at the front row.